Good morning, and thank you for joining us for another in our series of online programs. My name is Patrice Weaver with the Georgia Commission on the Holocaust. The Commission is a secular, nonpartisan state agency that strives to preserve the memory of the Holocaust and promote public understanding of the history. Today, we will continue in our series titled Rescue and Resistance, Stories of Courage. Now, before we begin, we have a quick housekeeping note. We have listened to your suggestions and we'll provide time at the conclusion of the presentation for questions. If you do have questions or comments, please post them in the group chat and we will get to as many as possible within our time limit. Again, please leave your microphones on mute. Thank you. And now it is my pleasure to turn the program over to Judy Shankup, a member of our Speakers Bureau. Judy?
Thank you, Patrice. Thank you everyone out there in Zoom land for joining me today. I wish I was with you in person, but these are crazy times. So we will settle for you, me, and the computer. Next slide, please. Oh, I'm sorry. Thank you. I'm going to share with you the stories of two Jewish men and one Jewish woman, their stories of resistance and rescue. And here, Stanley Stoll of the Jewish Foundation for the Righteous wrote these four statements. As insignificant as an act might seem, the absence of that act more often than not could be fatal. Each act of rescue is different. Each story is unique. The fact that it occurred is important. There is a wide range of rescue activities. An example is the story of Helen Weingarten, a local survivor who lives here in Atlanta. Helen and her family were deported to Auschwitz-Birkenau. At selection, some of her family was sent to the crematorium. Helen and other family members were selected for labor. Prisoners experienced selections constantly, not just on the day of arrival. During one of these selections, Helen's sister was selected to be gassed. Helen was selected for labor, so they were on two different lines. When the guard wasn't looking, Helen ran to her sister, grabbed her, and brought her to her line. Helen rescued her sister. Had she been caught, she probably would have been gassed with her sister. Helen and her sister survived the war. During tours, I remind people, it's not that people didn't resist. Most did not survive to tell their stories. Next slide. Deterrence and risks to rescue and resistance. The German use of violence, scarcity of food, medicine, extensive collaboration, widespread anti-Semitism, practical hurdles to escape and hiding, consequences of getting caught, the question that had to be answered, do I risk my family? The Nazis practiced collective punishment. So you were not only risking your own life, you were risking your family's life as well if you were, for example, hiding Jews and you were caught. These challenges are evident when I share my stories. This is a picture of Abba Kovner. He was both a poet and a resistance fighter, words you do not hear often together. Abba lived in the city of Vilna, a city that was part of Poland when World War II began. And you see, I wrote Lithuania, but Vilna was also called the Jerusalem of Lithuania. Vilna was a city that was constantly going between Poland and Lithuania, but it is today in Lithuania and we identify it as part of Lithuania. Here's a picture of a map where it took place. Before Germany invaded Poland and World War II began, Germany formed a pact with the Soviets to divide Poland and other countries between Germany and the Soviets. Despite this agreement that was supposed to last for 10 years, Germany attacked the Soviet Union in June 1941. Surprise, surprise, the Nazi government had lied. Now, the Soviets had been in Vilna for almost 2 years. Now there was a complete power shift when the Germans took over areas, including Vilna, where the Russians had occupied. The local people saw the Jews as collaborators with the Russians. One day, the Jews were living a normal life. The next day, they were being killed in the streets by their Lithuanian neighbors. The Jews were stunned by the betrayal of their Gentile neighbors. And what we see is a picture of the Kaunas pogrom, but this was occurring in Vilna as well. And Kaunas or Kovno is a city not too far away from Vilna. All these cities were experiencing the same thing. Tremendous numbers of Jews were brutally murdered by the local population. The Lithuanian militia probably killed more Jews by the end of 1941 than Germans did. Lithuania suffered the highest casualty rate of Jews in the Holocaust. When the Nazis occupied Vilna, now the Soviets are gone, they created ghettos. At first, when the Nazis forced Jews to live in the ghettos, some Jews felt they would be safer away from the local population. So the Nazis created a smaller camp, Ghetto 2, where they housed the elderly and children and people who could not work. And Ghetto number one, they housed people who could work. Jews felt that if they could work and benefit the German war effort, there was hope. After all, the idea of murdering all men, women, and children because they were Jewish was an unprecedented event. Conditions in the ghettos were horrendous. Starvation, lice, disease, death became a way of life. On the left-hand side, we see a picture of children in the Vilna ghetto. We know that 1.5 million children were murdered by the Nazis. So probably those children were part of the statistic. On the right-hand side, on the top, you can see the congestion of the Vilna ghetto. On the bottom, you see men going to work. Work was performed outside the ghetto as well as inside the ghetto. Over a period of time, Jews in the ghetto were rounded up and sent to the Ponor Forest, where they were forced to undress, line up in ditches, and shot. Most of the ghetto inhabitants were massacred this way. Abba Kovner, and there he is, became the head of the resistance movement. He had the ability to unite the Jews from different political and social organizations. That joke, two Jews, three opinions, it existed in the ghetto as well. As a resistance fighter, he snuck out of the ghetto on sabotage missions, smuggled weapons into the ghettos. He pleaded with the Jews to join the uprising, to join the resistance. And I quote, "Jewish youth, do not trust those who are trying to deceive you. Hitler plans to destroy all the Jews of Europe. We will not be led like sheep to the slaughter." He was the first person that we know of as a resistance fighter to make that statement that we are all going to be killed and we have to resist. It's not that if we work, we'll survive. And he said that even before the Wannsee Conference occurred, which was a meeting of 15 Nazi officials who gathered to discuss the logistics of how to murder all the Jews of Europe. And you can see in the background, this is the house. It's called the Wannsee House. This is where it took place outside Berlin. It's in a suburb, and it is today an education center. Here's a picture to the left of Abba and his future wife, Witke Kempner. They called their resistance movement the United Partisan Organization. Of course, that's the English translation. Abba felt strongly that Jews must fight as Jews and not be absorbed into Lithuanian or Russian partisan groups. His hope was to fight within the city of Vilna and convince others to join the resistance. When he realized that fighting in the city was impossible, he and about 300 other Jews escaped into the forest. Abba and his future wife obviously did survive. After the war, many felt that the upcoming trial, the Nuremberg trials, of some prominent Nazis wasn't enough to account for the crimes of the Holocaust. Abba formed an organization called the Avengers for Revenge. He planned to poison German reservoirs of 5 German cities. Abba went to Palestine, where he obtained poison. On his return trip, he heard his name called and emptied the canisters of poison into the ocean. Abba was arrested, but released shortly afterwards. Theory was that those opposed to the plot contacted the authorities. Abba then contacted his wife and said, "Let's go to Plan B." His organization infiltrated the POW camp of SS prisoners and brushed 3,000 loaves of bread with arsenic. The New York Times reported that 2,238 Nazis were sick. It is not clear if any died. I recently found out that a good friend of mine, his uncle was part of the Avengers. And I had met the uncle, but I didn't know that. And I would have loved to have spoken to him. He has since passed away. Abba then participated in the movement to smuggle Jewish Holocaust survivors from Europe to Palestine. And there he is, second to the top. He's disguised as a Jewish brigade. He also fought in Israel's War of Independence in 1948. Here is Abba in 1961 in Israel, and he is a witness in the Eichmann trials. And there's Eichmann to the left. He's behind the bulletproof shield. Abba Kovner built a reputation as a poet. Here are two covers of his books, two of his books. Little Sister of Mine depicts the tragedy of execution and separation of Jewish children during the war. He died at the age of 69 in 1987. He died of cancer of the larynx. This eloquent man was unable to speak towards the end of his life. The next person I'm going to talk about is Rosa Robuta. And here she is. Rosa is standing on the left-hand side. And this is a picture that depicts the sweetness of school-aged children together. It's heartbreaking knowing what the future held for them in Nazi-occupied Poland. So Rosa, and here is a map. You can see where Poland is. Rosa was from a small city outside of Warsaw called Szczekanów. My father-in-law was from the same city. So a few years back ago, my husband and I visited the city. We hired a guide, and unbeknownst to us, the guide had contacted the director of a small museum in Shekhanov. This museum was supposed to be closed that day that we were going to visit, but the director opened the museum for us, and he gave us a tour of both the city and the museum and spent the day with us. And of course, I saw a picture of Rosa in the museum. It's a small museum, a little bit like our museums here. There's a 14th century castle outside of Shekhanov where Jews and resistance fighters were executed. Today, it is a tourist site. Furthermore, Jews who were deported to Auschwitz were also kept there. Rosa and her family were arrested and sent to Auschwitz-Birkenau. Her family was immediately murdered in Birkenau. And to the left you see, as we talked about, when you got to Auschwitz-Birkenau, there were selections. Most people were selected to go to the gas chambers. They were not even registered. And to the left, you see pictures of men at the top going to the gas chambers. Below it, you see Hungarian Jews who were picked for labor. On the right-hand side, you see the entranceway to Auschwitz-Birkenau, I'm sorry, to Birkenau. Auschwitz is actually a camp 2 miles away from Birkenau. Birkenau is where Jewish genocide occurred. The Nazis built 4 large crematoria in Birkenau, and for the most part, that's where the Jews went. Rosa was selected for work near a munition factory. And the people from Shekhanov they knew each other and they kind of stayed together. One day she was approached by a man from Shekhanov who was in the resistance movement. And he asked her to organize girls to smuggle gunpowder for explosives from the munitions factory. She did it, and these girls smuggled the gunpowder for months. This same man survived the war, and I'm going to quote what he said when he talks about Rosa. He said, her eyes would light up with revenge when she had the possibility of operating against the enemy. On the right-hand side is a picture I took when I visited Birkenau several years ago. And I have to share with you, I have been to many Holocaust museums, but nothing prepared me for what the dwelling barracks were really like. I mean, I was in this barrack decades later, and there was still an odor. And at the very bottom of the bunks, it's just dirt. That's all. And you could imagine, I mean, people slept there, and you could imagine when it rained, it was nothing more than mud. Here's an aerial photograph of 2 of the crematoria at Birkenau. The resistance wanted to blow up 2 of the crematoria. And a crematorium is a building where there are gas chambers and ovens to burn the bodies. On October 7th, 1944, the uprising occurred. Crematorium 4 was destroyed. The Sonderkommandos were all killed. Sonderkommandos were the Jewish prisoners who worked in the crematoria. Hundreds of prisoners escaped. The SS quickly put down the revolt. The Polish underground outside the camp did not help the escapees despite agreeing to do so. Most were caught and killed. The SS traced the gunpowder back to the factory. Rosa and these four young women were arrested. Alla Gertner, Esther Waschblum, Regina Schafferstein, I apologize, I do not speak Polish or Yiddish. I'm sure I messed up her name. The SS severely tortured the girls to reveal the names of their fellow conspirators. They only gave up the names of the Sandow commandos because they knew they were already dead. When I use the word torture, the Nazis were brutal. I can't imagine how they did not give up names. I know since the pandemic, I have probably seen almost all the Holocaust movies that are out there on Netflix and other places. And I fast forward through the torture scenes. So once again, I just can't imagine how these women were so brave. Here are names, 11 names that we know of women who smuggled gunpowder for the uprising. The four women were hanged just 2 weeks before the liberation of Auschwitz-Birkenau. The entire women's camp was forced to watch the executions. The last message smuggled from Esther Waschblum, I quote, "I know what is in store for me, but I go readily to the gallows. I only ask you to take care of my sister, Hanka. Please don't leave her so that I may die easier." And if I go back to that list of names, Hanka's name is there. Hanka is her sister. Hanka did survive the war. Here are Rosa's last words. "Be strong and brave." She expressed that she felt good knowing that the resistance would continue. Their act of defiance and courage forced the Nazis to recognize them as individuals. They were executed as resistance fighters, direct order from Berlin. Rosa Robutta was 23. Here is a picture of the remains of one of the crematoria as you would see it today. The Nazis blew up the three remaining crematoria before fleeing Auschwitz. Auschwitz-Birkenau today is a museum. One of the biggest challenges is how the crematoria can be preserved outside in the elements. Today, there is a state-of-the-art preservation center that I toured in Auschwitz. This is a movie about the uprising. It was created in 2001 and is called The Gray Zone. It is a fictional movie. The last person I'm going to talk about is Walter Suskind. Walter was a German Jew living in the Netherlands when the Nazis occupied Amsterdam and the Netherlands. And here is our map again, showing you where the Netherlands is. This is a picture of the Dutch theater. Walter became the director of this theater, which was used as a collection point for Jews who were then sent to Westerbork transit camp. So as director of the staff, he was responsible for registering the Jews. And here to the left, you see a picture of Jewish people being registered. He was responsible for providing food, clothing, medical care. Conditions were horrendous. There was also a card index system, which was guarded by the Germans. Somehow, Walter Suskind was able to alter cards to allow both children and adults to escape. On the right, you see a picture of the alley, which is behind the theater with Jewish people just hanging out. And below, you see a picture of this girl waving to her friend, who was a non-Jewish girl who took the picture, and her friend was in a building. This is Vesterborg Transit Camp. This is where people were being sent. And I'm going to go back a second. I just have to add something. Adults hid in the theater until they could be smuggled out. They needed to find a safe place to go. There are so many different moving parts and so many different people who worked within the resistance movement to make these escapes happen. And again, this is the picture of Vesterborg Transit Camp. Anne Frank and her family were there. It was built originally as a refugee camp to house German and Austrian Jewish refugees, but it became a transit camp for Dutch Jews in July 1942. Vesterborg was a different kind of camp. There was no starvation. Families stayed together. People were given jobs. There was a false sense that everything will be okay. I toured the camp 2 years ago, and our guide told us this story. She said a sick baby was born in Vesterborg. The head of the camp rented an incubator for the baby for about 3 months. When the baby was healthy, the baby was sent to Auschwitz. Is such an element of deceit. Back to Amsterdam and back to the Dutch theater, which you see on the left-hand side. This is an aerial view. So on the top left-hand side, you see the Dutch theater. You see a very wide boulevard and you see the site of a creche, which is another word for the nursery. And Susskind convinced the Nazis to keep children out of the Dutch theater and in this nursery. He said that it would be less chaotic if the children were kept there. Now, next to the nursery, there was a teacher's college. And today that teacher's college is a National Holocaust Museum. On the right-hand side and on the lower left-hand side are pictures of children who were in that nursery. And again, I'm going to say the same thing. We know that 1.5 million children were killed during the Holocaust. Chances are the pictures we're seeing today of these children, that was all that they're part of the statistic. I look at the left-hand side at the bottom, there's a little girl with curly blonde hair, and I just can't help it. I take this very personally because that looks just like I did when I was that age. Above on the left-hand side is a picture in the courtyard that you would see today outside the National Museum, and they have pictures that you're looking at today. Walter Susskind approached the principal, the head of the school, the teacher's school, and he asked him to help them hide children. Johann von Holst agreed to do it. Now, one of the issues was that it was difficult to convince parents to allow children to leave the nursery, and it was difficult to find homes. But despite that, Johann von Holst did help quite a bit, and he was honored by Yad Vashem as righteous among the nations for saving between 600 to 1,000 children. He died at 107 in 2018. In von Holst's own words, after he is told that the next day all children would be deported, he said, and I quote, "Now try to imagine 80, 90, perhaps 70 or 100 children standing there, and you have to decide which children to take with you. That was the most difficult day of my life. You realize that you cannot possibly take all the children with you. You know for a fact that the children you leave behind are going to die. I took 12 with me. Later on, I asked myself, why not 13? Children were smuggled out in laundry baskets and sacks and passed to trusted people. And they were smuggled out in so many different ways. During walks, children were smuggled away and replaced with reserve children via the teacher training college next door. And here you see a picture of the tram, which played a part in all of this, because when the tram went by, the guards who was standing guard at the Dutch theater could not see what was going on in front of the nursery. They didn't really bother to post guards at the nursery. So this was also an opportunity to smuggle children. On July 23rd, 1943, the nursery is cleared by the Germans. The act of smuggling children and adults out of the theater was never discovered. Walter Suskind was perceived by fellow Jews as a Nazi collaborator. After all, no one knew about the resistance, except those who were involved. And all they saw was a man fraternizing with the Nazis and the guards. He spoke German, he was a German, he smoked cigarettes with them. And so that was their perception of him. He and his wife and daughter were sent to Westerbork, then to Theresienstadt. And I will tell you, he did have the opportunity, the resistance did offer Walter and his family the opportunity to go into hiding, but he did not do so. From there, they were sent to Auschwitz, where his wife and daughter were gassed upon arrival. Suskind was picked for labor, but did not survive. It is not known for certain when and how he died. There's a movie about Walter Suskind, called Suskind, The Untold Story of Survival, 2012. It could be on Netflix, I'm not sure. Another good movie is a movie about collaboration in the Netherlands. It's called Riphagen, The Untouchable. It was produced in 2016. It was in the Jewish Film Festival. Here is a picture of our most famous target, Anne Frank. Less than 25% of Dutch Jewry survived the Holocaust. Why were 75% of Jews in the Netherlands murdered? The death rates in other Western occupied countries were much lower. Belgium, it was 40%. France, 25%. Norway, 40%. Some reasons were Dutch Nazis collaborated with the Germans. There were more Dutch collaborators than Dutch resistors. The population was highly dense, so it was difficult to hide people. The landscape was flat. There was no extensive forest like in the Ukraine. It was the only country to have bounty hunters. There was a fear of tough reprisals from the Germans. Jews in the Netherlands did not experience the level of historic anti-Semitism as in other countries. Jews may have had a false sense of security. The Jews also had a traditional deference to authority, just like the German Jews. That concludes my presentation. I thank you for joining me today. And now we will return to Patrice.
Thank you so much, Judy. That was wonderful. We're now at the end of this section of the presentation. A huge thank you to Judy Shankup for giving us her time, sharing her expertise, her personal photos, and the stories about her travels with us. As ever, if you have questions about today's presentation or would like to suggest future topics, please email me, Patrice Weaver, at patriceweaver@holocaust.georgia.gov. This presentation, as well as all of our previous ones, will be posted on our YouTube channel in a few days. You may find the link on our website, and our website is www.holocaust.georgia.gov. It is our hope that you will take the lessons of the Holocaust to heart and share what you have learned today. This is Patrice Weaver. On behalf of the Georgia Commission on the Holocaust, we thank you for joining us today.